This episode of Friends of Flo is brought to you by NCLEX Mastery. If you're a nursing student and you're about to take your NCLEX, you need to go to the App Store right now and download NCLEX Mastery.
Hey, welcome to Friends of Flo, everyone. I'm Andy Whitters.
And I'm Rebecca Porter. And we have a guest with us today. Would you like to introduce him?
Yes, I would. And this is Jerry Horak. Jerry is, he's a DNP student as well. And he's a nurse. I'm really proud to have him on here today.
I'm really welcoming you, Jerry.
So welcome, Jerry. Welcome, Friends of Flo.
Thank you.
So appreciate it. We're doing a series right now on men in nursing. And so we're really happy to have Jerry here. Jerry, can you fill us in a little bit about how it was that you ended up in nursing?
So I originally started off doing something completely different, and then discovering that that really wasn't what I wanted to do or wasn't for me. So I kind of spent the first decade or my 20s basically doing nothing, you know, but dead-end jobs. So I kind of discovered that one day I either had to get a job like in a factory or I had to go to school. So I, my mom was a nurse and I used to watch ER. You remember ER? And
that kind of actually
looked interesting, like a good pace, something that you can change. The environment changes a lot. So I kind of thought that's something that I would take to. So then I did my associate's degree and have done my RN to BSN and master's, and now I'm doing the DNP.
Cool.
That's amazing. What kind of nursing are you doing?
Right now I'm doing peds, which is, I started in adult ICU and have just kind of, every time I transfer, it's always because of hours. It's not necessarily because of the patient population. It's
sure.
Started on nights, and then I wanted to go to days, so I went to PACU for a while. And then I wanted the Monday through Friday job, so I did a sedation job, which was basically clinic hours. And going back to school, I wanted to do just weekend options, so I went to the pediatric floor.
I see. It's a step down, like post-surgical floor?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can you walk us through what a typical day is like with your patients in particular?
I work weekends. I work nights. So basically you get there at 7 p.m., do your assessments, do your meds, try to tuck them in. It all depends on the kid, the kid's age. Usually you let the parents, if it's a smaller kid, kind of take control. Cluster your cares so you're not waking up the babies at midnight.
You know,
try to get things done before they go to sleep or when they're awake in the middle of the night. That's kind of it. Just play it by ear.
Yeah.
So what propelled you to do a DNP?
Just after you've done this something for so long, you realize that you can do more. And I guess with more, if you want to do more, you have to get more education and more licensure.
What did you do your master's degree in?
It was nursing administration. And then I decided I didn't really want to take, I didn't want to deal with other people's problems. You know, that's kind of like what management is.
Yeah, it is. A lot of fixing and leading stuff. So what are you doing your DNP in?
Family nurse practitioner.
Cool.
That's awesome. Okay, great. So relating to our series of men in nursing, do you have any just initial comments or observations with your current practice being in peds on a post-surgical floor? Are there any standouts for you as a male in this profession? I mean, I would assume, as in most areas of nursing, there's more women compared to men. What's it like on your floor?
So I work with one other guy. Like in the ICUs, when I did ICU, it really wasn't, I mean, there was definitely a lot more females than males, but there was still a good proportion of males in the intensive care units. Peds, like I said, there was one other guy and all other females, and I think we were the first two males hired on that unit, but it's a fairly new unit. But it's a younger group, and I think they're happy to have the male influence.
Yeah, sure. Okay.
You know, when I started nursing several decades ago, guys in nursing were really rare. And the social, societal, I guess, stereotype of guys that would go into nursing were sexually oriented. That a guy would only go into nursing because he was gay.
Yeah.
That it was seen as very much a feminine, what women do are nurses, teachers, or secretaries. And few women were in medical school. And now that whole trend of it is really changing. And I read an article recently that said sort of in the next 5 to 10 years, 20% of nursing students will be guys.
Yeah.
And I think that's really, really interesting. And medical school classes are now, some of them are more than 50% women. So there's this real shift in thinking. How do patients accept, for both of you guys, how do patients accept having guys as a nurse?
Yeah.
Particularly women.
Well, first of all, I mean, just to back up the comment there regarding men in nursing, I think you're right. I think the old-timey rationale was you either were not smart enough to be a doctor or you were, for some reason, gay. So I think that our culture is turning the page on this. And it is okay to be a guy and go into the nursing field. And I've made this point in the past that nursing is a really tough profession. You have to be physically in shape. You have to be smart. You have to be able to multitask. You have to be well organized. You have to be a really thoughtful and good communicator. So there are a lot of things that make up the qualities of a nurse that it's really and fun for and engaging for any person despite your sex. Right. I mean, let's just be real. And so, but I think that there is some of that pervasive stereotype that still exists.
Do you still encounter that?
Well, I do. I particularly encounter it with, frankly, some of the older.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking.
Yeah. Mostly physicians, unfortunately. Right. And so I just think it's unfortunate. But I enjoy blowing up that stereotype, you know, as a guy, you know. I suppose that some guys might think, well, it's easier to work with women rather than a whole bunch of guys like in a male-dominated field.
And I think the same for women, that I think that there's a tempering effect to have guys around.
Yeah.
You know, you were talking before we started recording, Andy, about the cattiness and grouching and gossiping that goes on and how irritating you find that.
Yes, yeah. And so this is a personal experience, just to clarify. I mean, so I like Jerry, I mean, I started my career in pediatrics, and that's one of the things that I did not enjoy about my initial job in nursing was the pervasive cattiness, the gossip. And again, this is in my experience. It primarily came from my female colleagues, and it was really hard for me to adjust to that because frankly, I didn't really care about the gossip culture.
Right.
It wasn't my scene. Like I wanted to be at work, have fun, take care of a bunch of kids, and if I got to hang out with some really cool coworkers, and
that was icing on the cake.
That was. And sadly, I mean, that's initially what drove me away from my very first job was the catty culture that I was in was not it was no longer attractive to me.
So if I can interrupt here, Andy, one of the things that when we look at the continuum of bullying, what we call bullying, and I call it incivility, it goes from sort of the eye rolling, sighing when somebody says something, all the way to the physical violence of people throwing things or hitting somebody. But that gossiping and socially isolating somebody, that kind of bullying that goes on and the gossiping that goes on is a huge driver for nurses to leave a job. And so your experience of leaving. So I kind of wonder, one of the papers that I found that was really interesting is called Men Are From Mars, and it's by Christensen in 2018 in Nurse Education and Practice. And it's based on their research is written, done by guys and one woman, professors in Australia, but based on that really seminal book called Men Are From Mars, Women Are From Venus. And without stereotyping people, men tend to be more direct communicators, and women talk more about feelings.
Yeah, I would say that in my experience, I think that's been fairly
true. And so
true.
To have men and women together, I'm wondering if that can help with the incivility in a unit. Do you see any of that, Jerry?
I think so. women tend to, speak around things or in a circular motion, whereas men are more direct.
Yeah.
And
do you think women are trying to build consensus more, whether that's positive consensus or negative consensus, whereas guys will, in my life experience, is that guys will say, okay, here's the problem, this is what we're going to do to fix it.
I could see that, like trying to get people on board with what they're thinking versus
yeah,
a guy might not necessarily care as much about that. I don't know if that's true or not, but.
Mm-hmm. What... Going back to your nursing education, what was it like as a student to be, were you the only guy?
In my ADN, there were three of us.
Out of how many?
Probably 25.
Wow, that's really low.
Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe there was, I don't know.
But there was a handful.
Yeah,
less than a handful.
Yep.
And what was it like?
It was fine. I think... again, that was kind of, we were all new and nobody knew what nursing was or how it was supposed to be. So you forged
your own way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And my first instructor there was a guy too. So that kind of helped.
Oh, interesting. And that helped. Did you notice a difference between women instructors and men instructors?
He was pretty direct. He was, like me, just kind of, can I say smart ass?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
You can say.
So a lot like that. The females were fine too. There was just one that was kind of flippant, and she was an exception to any rule though.
Good. Okay.
I think it was, well, in my bachelor's education, there was only two of us guys in our class. And we were thankfully good friends. I think somewhat naturally. I mean, we stuck out like sore thumbs in a sea of women. I mean, and I think our class was 30 people. But professionally, as I grew into my role, and I was married and everything, I remember coming home and I would talk to my wife about my friends at work, and she then one day she just kind of stopped me and said, well, gosh, you have a lot of female friends like this. I mean, should I be concerned? I'm like, well, Jen, like I'm in the field of
nursing,
of nursing, And so, but it was, I think it made me realize like, oh man, I guess I do. I have a lot of, female friends and coworkers, and my wife was just, I mean, she just didn't, I don't think she thought it through initially. I mean, but like naturally,
I hadn't thought of what it would be like. That's
so,
really
so
interesting.
So it was kind of weird as we reflected on it. It's like, yeah, I naturally had just more female colleagues and that had naturally turned into friends. And so that was kind of an interesting, just sort of an interesting process. I mean, as I grew into my professional shoes, I think. Earlier we had talked about, I mean, we had just briefly brought up what men can bring to the care of a patient that might be different. We had talked about communication. I do think that my flavor of communication does tend to be a little more direct, especially when I'm talking to families about a loved one's diagnosis or even a patient's diagnosis. I sort of rip it off like a bandit. Hey, this is what you have. And hey, do you have any questions about that? And then we get into discussing options for care and treatment. And I sort of finish it off with, well, let's just talk about our feelings. Well, how do you feel good about this plan of care right now? You know, that's sort of been my sort of overall approach. And that's worked well for me with kids to old people alike. It comes, I think, initially, especially when you're delivering news of a diagnosis, it's just not an easy way.
So I wonder for nurses out there who are bedside nurses,
yeah,
or frontline bedside nurses, what is it like? You know, usually a patient has been given the diagnosis, that you're not the one giving a diagnosis, like you might be as a nurse practitioner.
I see, yeah, right.
And so
yeah, that's a good point.
So you are really dealing with the feelings and the responses. And so as a guy, what is it like when a patient is in that domain of I need to process and feel this?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
When your method of communication is more about the direct and less about the feelings. Is that a question?
I think it's a fair question. I mean, when I was working at bedside, I found the most annoying thing was when a physician would come in, deliver the news, and walk out. Like that to me was just, it didn't do anyone any favors on the healthcare team. I mean, it just riled up emotions. It riled up, anger especially for patients' families.
Always the 40 questions to follow,
right,
too.
Right, yeah.
You know, so who's going to answer those?
And that always just kind of fell on the nurse,
yep.
male or female.
Right,
and
of course.
I think the nursing approach in that regard is truly like it's an asexual thing. I mean, you have to give...
Compassion,
yeah,
and
you
directness.
Have to give, right, and I think compassion, directness, empathy, although... I think those are just attributed to being female or feminine.
And there's such a blurring between, I really think there's a paradigmatic shift that feelings belong to women and...
Well, and
go ahead,
not
Jerry.
All the patients are the same either. So
right.
Very true.
Like what one might like or need isn't necessarily what the other will want.
I think you have a particularly difficult job in pediatrics, because you're dealing with parents.
Mm-hmm.
And depending on the age of the child, their ability to understand.
Mm-hmm.
They can intuit a lot, but they may not have the verbal skills to express. And then you've got the whole thing of, well, how functional are the parents? And
yep.
How are they getting along? And I cannot imagine the stress parents must be under. A, having children, and B, having a sick child, and then C, being in the hospital, having to make hard decisions. And so as a nurse at the bedside in pediatrics, I think you're balancing even more.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I think that's
true. And I think that there's a balance too with some of the cultural things that that will come across in pediatrics every once in a while. The one that I can think of that I remember living through was a family who they were against males taking care of like their family members, but they had this sort of quasi religious belief that men shouldn't be caring for their young child.
Really?
So we had to kind of back off on this and get together as a unit and say, well, how do we keep?
Mm-hmm.
How do we keep me and this and my other male colleague, you know, just out of the orbit?
Professionally
out of the orbit of this family. That was a bit odd, you know, because a physician or the conventional medical doctor could go into the room and have a therapeutic touch for the child, give advice, participate in some kind of activities with a child, but yet my role as a caretaker, as a nurse, was sort of blunted. It was sort of walled off. And I remember that was like probably like one of the first times I ever felt like, well, God, being a guy in this profession kind of sucks, you know, because I can't do my job. I can't exercise my training and my knowledge to help this this patient and the family too, for that matter. But I found that to be like a really annoying thing.
I think it also raises some very interesting ethical questions for parallel situations. I'm wondering if let's take a break here.
Sure.
And we'll come back in a couple of minutes to continue this really important question that you've raised about what is it like to be a guy whose presence as a nurse, the family has said, no, you can't do it. We don't want a guy. Or a patient says, I don't want a guy. Or even the question of a woman, of women patients being asked, is it okay if your nurse is a guy? So let's take a break here.
Yes. Okay.
And we'll carry on from then.
All right.
Here at NCLEX Mastery, we love nurses and especially nursing students, but we need your feedback about this podcast. If you have ideas on topics or you have questions you want us to answer, shoot us a message, leave a comment, go to our Facebook page, and just tell us what you think, because we want to help you in the most specific way that you need that help. Thank you so much.
And we're back. Welcome back to Friends of Flo. I'm Andy Whitters.
And I'm Rebecca Porter, and we have our guest Jerry with us today. Jerry is a pediatric nurse, and he's a DNP student in family practice, right?
Yep, correct.
So when we took our break, we were just getting into the topic of patients or families requesting that a guy not provide care for their family member or for themselves.
Correct.
And did you want to pick up with what you were thinking and sort of the story you were telling?
Oh, I don't know if there's much of a storyline. I think it's just unique that we have a culture that asks female nurses, like, hey, do you feel comfortable? Or we ask our
female patients.
Our female patients might be informed that a male nurse is taking care of them.
And is it okay?
Right. And I think that's just sort of a... It's a bizarre sort of feature,
right? Because
as part of being a male in the profession,
it's, correct. I think so too. And when I look historically back at nursing was 100% women, and so men never had a choice. It was women doing personal body care for men, and there were never any questions asked.
Right. Yeah.
And now women patients are being asked, is it okay if Tony, the guy nurse, is your nurse today?
Correct. Yeah. I think it's just unique. I mean, I'm always there to honor the wishes of the patients. It's just sort of an annoyance, I guess. I mean, so guys, for instance, who might be getting their prostate checked, every once in a while, you might have a guy that wants to have a male provider do their examination versus a woman. And part of that's like with the same rationale that a woman might want to have a female do their pelvic examination. It's highly personal. You want to be able to identify, the parts of your body with another person who's better than
who can identify with an examiner, right?
Who's of the same sex. And so,
But in nursing, I think it's different because
it is different in nursing.
It is different in bedside nursing, no matter what kind of nursing, you are doing intimate personal care.
Yeah.
For patients.
All over the place. I mean, it's not just the matter of taking someone to the bathroom or doing a pelvic examination. I mean, it's. I think of my time at the bedside. I mean, just doing various activities. I mean, even just reducing a patient just the sight of being in a gown. I mean, it's think about how vulnerable a person is. I mean, they're not fully clothed. Their various body parts are just exposed. You know, people that have scars, like, you know, on an extremity, they might be embarrassed about. It's just out in the open. You know,
for everyone to see.
And so for me as a caretaker, as a nurse, that's all part of the human experience, no matter if you're male or female or whatever. And so if a patient has requested that I not take care of them because I'm a male, I just tend to back down. I just say, well, okay, that's fine. We're going to find another person.
Well,
Jerry,
has this happened to you?
Oh, yeah.
Really? Can you think of a time?
Especially now in pediatrics, you know, you're getting into the 17, 16-year-old females.
Oh, right. Yeah.
You know, it's kind of, if you don't want me, I'm not that offended, you know?
Yeah, of course. So, yeah. And you can't be offended, you know? I mean,
yeah.
It's based on their choice. It's based on the family's choices. Yeah. I mean, you have to be able to support them.
Most don't care. Most really don't care. And usually, like, catheterizations and stuff like that, I do the guys and you know, you get
your female colleagues to do the
women.
Yep. Huh, I didn't know that. What happens if you have a shift of all guys? And that's going to happen. If it hasn't happened already,
that's entirely possible.
When I worked in the intensive care unit, we did have one night where there was all guys assigned to the one unit.
Mm-hmm.
And there was one patient that insisted on having a female, so they moved the patient.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because our nurse manager at the time was a guy too, and he's like, okay, we'll move you.
Yeah.
I wonder what happens in an emergency room, because the time is going to come when it will be all men.
Well, and statistically, there are more guys that go into, like, the more
high acuity or the
high acuity, high intense.
And so, I mean, I know at our local VA here, it's roughly half and half, which is kind of interesting when you look at, like, the dispersion of males amongst the nursing profession. It's interesting, but we do what we can to accommodate to our patients, just like any female, like, coworker would, I think.
So I have an interesting question. Sometimes particularly younger women nurses have comments with a sexual innuendo.
Yeah.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. We'll edit that part. Sometimes particularly young women nurses have patients make comments that have a sexual innuendo to them. And I don't know that a lot of young women are particularly ready to give back, set boundaries. And does that ever happen to guys? From women patients,
or
family
coworkers.
Members or coworkers.
Yeah. I think it happens to guys. I just don't think that in my experience, and this is just in my experience, like I just don't think guys talk about it, nor do I think like they really care sometimes. I mean seriously,
it's kind of flattering. No.
Yeah. Let's face it, I think guys generally, like, if they get catcalled here, Rebecca, I think most guys are like, oh, hey, like, yeah. I guess someone like thinks I look nice. Like, I mean, like, I think that's, and again, this is my opinion. I think that guys think that, oh, someone's trying to give me a compliment, and just kind of drops off the, off their radar.
So I think, I wonder if, this is really interesting. I wonder if because of the history of the hegemony, sexual hegemony of men in our society, that women have been victims, and I'll use that word, victims and targets of intentional sexual power and by men.
Right, the subjugation of women.
Exactly, and nurses.
And nurses in particular have been subjugated. That has always been a repeated topic here.
So for women nurses to have comments made about them in their presence or to them, I'm wondering if it's different than it is for guys. And that's what I think you're saying.
I think, I personally think it might be, yeah.
Go ahead,
it's
Jerry.
It's always much more condescending, it seems, like when I witness this. And a lot of times it's women making these comments like, oh, Dad, you've got a pretty one tonight. Or, oh, Dad, don't pitch them, you know, stuff like that.
Oh, right. Like, yeah, that's right.
So
that's...
when you hear that, what do you think? Jeez. What do you think when you hear that as guys and nurses? What do you think?
So I think that, I mean, I think my reaction is very similar to what I think a female would feel if comments are being made about her or her or her sex. I mean, for me, I just, I think it's just kind of rude. I think it's unprofessional.
So do you ever call a patient or a family member on those comments? Can you ever feel empowered enough to say, as a guy, saying, you know, you've crossed a boundary here. This is a professional person looking after you. This person is highly trained, mm-hmm. well-educated, and we don't tolerate comments like that here.
Now, so yes, back when I was working at the bedside, I probably would not have said anything because I probably would have been too scared, frankly. I mean, like, just, I just want to keep my head down. And work. Yeah. And just, and like,
Jerry, talk about that.
So now with more age and experience, and it's usually the 22-year-old girls that get these comments, the new nurses.
Yeah.
I will now interject, you know, and say, yeah, and they're really smart too. And, you know, they, that kind of stuff. Or,
sure.
Yeah. And we do press charges against people who assault nurses, you know.
Yeah.
Just kind of.
You're setting a kind of little boundary kind here. Of,
you know, do you realize what you're saying? And
mm-hmm. I'm particularly, one of the topics that really presses my hot button is the sexualization of nurses. And as a woman who's through decades of nurses and the sexual fantasies and the comments that were made to me when I was a bedside nurse a long time ago. And I think I could sometimes joke about it with the patient and flip it back on them because, using your word, Jerry, I was a bit of a smart ass as mm-hmm. well. But learning and empowering your colleagues and your coworkers to stand up for themselves and to help those 20-something-year-old nurses, women, to find the words and to say, hey, I witnessed that.
Mm-hmm.
And here's some language that you might want to use. Here's some wording that can help empower you. And I urge everybody out there to really think of ways to and practice what you're going to say when that happens. And what are you going to say as a guy when a parent or the patient says, I'd rather have a woman doing this.
Mm-hmm.
And when there are no other women around, and no, we can't move you to a different unit. There are no other beds. Your nurse today is Greg. Greg is, or Tom are going to be your nurses today. And we're happy to know that you're uncomfortable. We will respect your privacy. These are well-trained, highly educated people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And really helping. But how do we deal, and I'll be interested in comments from people out there about how do you deal with the cultural differences when it really is a truly a different culture that doesn't allow men to see women or women to see men?
Well, sometimes it doesn't allow men to like exercise their ability to care and exercise empathy. Like that's what I find it to be annoying.
Good comment,
Because I always find it annoying that, I had this every once in a while when I was in peds, like, family members would sometimes just make comments, oh, well, you're a guy. Like, do you really know how to change a diaper? Or like, I mean, like little comments that would sort of challenge my ability to care for a baby in some cases, or the ability to relate. I mean, yeah, I can empathize, and yes, I am a dude. Mm-hmm. and you know what? Like, yeah, I really stick out in this unit full of women. I'm the only guy here that wears size 15. Yeah, I see that's kind of weird. But you know what? I really enjoy taking care of I really enjoy taking care of people. And so, and I would argue, actually, I mean, especially given this current state of our culture with the hashtag Me Too movement, you know, like the recent Gillette ads that are out there, I think that the ability to exercise empathy and to show it makes you more of a
guy.
More of a man.
I do
too. I think
too.
It makes you more of a well-rounded person. So when I frame my profession to mostly students, even as a preceptor for my DNP students or people who rotate with me, I make sure that they have sort of a passion for thinking outside the box. I mean, I think that what nurses need, innovators. whether you're male or female.
But we can stop it, and I think it is going to stop as more guys get into nursing. I hope so.
Because we our profession is the owners. We are the owners, of that model of care. I think that's what distinguishes us away from the medical model. We maintain a scientific approach, but we use a lot of social cues and research to execute our care. So I make sure that
try being a woman in nursing at Halloween
to take care of people, do it in an innovative way, and search for answers. Being a lifelong learner. So I don't know if those are completely unique aspects of being a nurse, but when I speak about my profession to students, that's how I get pretty heady with it, I guess.
Great. And Jerry, how do you feel yourself changing, or your perception of nursing change as you moved through your master's degree? Because that is a changing, education changes us. Mm-hmm. And I am not the same person that I was before I did a master's degree and before I did a PhD. I'm different.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm really interested in how your thinking has changed, what you think about nursing as you move through your DNP.
Still,
I'm sorry to put you on the spot.
No,
like that.
I kind of look at what we as the profession need to change within ourselves. I think it's kind of a profession that has too long let other professions define it, if that makes sense. We do what we think other people want us to do. And I think we need to take some ownership of our profession and just...
I see that changing. I see that younger nurses are coming to the profession and practice with a confidence different than what I had and what I was even just a few years ago. I'm part of a conversation with the ANA, American Nurses Association Leadership Circle, and a woman emailed in yesterday or the day before, and she's 80 years old, and she's maintained her RN license, and she is with the Red Cross Disaster Services, and gets deployed all over the place in her ninth decade of life.
Wow.
And she has a PhD.
What I want it to be.
Mm-hmm. Reading the work that she does, I just think we are prepared and are being prepared for a lifetime of being able to serve and to be a role model for others coming behind us.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I thank mm-hmm. you guys very much for the conversation today. And thank you, Jerry.
Thank you.
For coming and joining us. And best wishes in your DNP pursuit. I know you'll get there.
Thanks for coming on, Jerry.
Thank you.
So this is Rebecca signing off. And remember to keep your stick on the ice.
All right. And this is Andy Whitters telling you to innovate, agitate, and educate. Thank you.
Take care.
Friends of Flo is brought to you by NCLEX Mastery. Go to the App Store right now, download NCLEX Mastery, and before you leave, if you could just share this with your nursing friends, tell them about us, leave us feedback, go to our Facebook page, tell us what you liked, tell us what you didn't love so much, be nice. But thank you so much. We really appreciate you.